Hey, this is Roy Samuelson. Thanks for tuning in to another Encore presentation of the ADNA Presents. We have Slau Halatyn joining us. There's a lot of very special things about this interview that I'm excited to share with you again. It's a short little 25-minute. And if you're interested in learning more about audio description, there's so many great resources out there. There's the Audio Description Project. There is the Facebook group Audio Description Discussion. And over 150 interviews here on this podcast, the ADNA Presents. And if you're more interested in a Kindle version, the ADNA Presents Know Your Narrator Volume 1 of interviews that have been happening here in the podcast of Voice Talents. It's now available on Kindle. Go to the ADNA Presents. You'll find Volume 1 available for you. And with a little disclaimer from the original episode, here we go. Because of a last-minute job that came up, I had to get to the destination before I was able to record this interview, so you're going to hear some really horrible audio from my side, but thankfully Slau makes up for it. I think you're really going to enjoy this podcast. Thanks for tuning in. Welcome to the ADNA Presents. Today we have a very special guest, Slau Halatyn. He is an audio magician. He's a mix wizard and audio engineer and producer. He's a studio owner in New York City. Thanks so much for joining us, Slau.
Oh, thank you so much, Roy. It's a pleasure to be here.
What do you love about audio description?
Aside from the obvious, as a blind consumer, to be able to really get the full picture, so to speak, what I love about it is that my wife, who is fully sighted, now watches programs without me with audio description. Because it's just, in the dark ages when she would have to describe on the fly stuff. I mean, we all know the challenges that poses, because you're trying to watch, you're trying to understand, you're trying to concisely describe, you're trying to remember characters' names, like all of that stuff compounds upon itself. And the great thing is that when we're watching something together, I mean, it really helps her to follow the storyline, to remember the character names and stuff like that. So I think that to me is like the biggest plus of all with audio description.
Oh, very cool. Great to hear it. And you identified yourself as a consumer of audio description. You're also a professional. Could you address some of the intersections there as far as your work in audio?
Yeah, I mean, I am a blind audio engineer. I was sighted, up until I was in college, and then I lost vision because of retinitis pigmentosa. It was a very slow progression, but it did affect me in terms of being able to do the college work I needed to do. I was originally enrolled in an industrial design program, so it was a highly visual thing. But I always had a passion for audio, always was a musician and a studio, like a session player and stuff. But I never considered that a full-time career. I never considered it as a possibility. Well, then after a period of time where I could not do any real industrial design work, I decided to go back to school for audio engineering. And I still had enough vision to be able to, with some adaptive technology, get through all of my course material and stuff like that. And even if I had to, say, look at a VU meter to establish proper recording levels or something, if I put my nose up against a meter, I could make it out, But over time, even that became impossible. Luckily, I was studying around the time when digital audio workstations started becoming a viable option for recording in recording studios. And so I was even trained in that regard. And my work primarily focused around music recording. I ended up doing a lot of orchestral recording and stuff like that. But then it also essentially expanded over to voiceover recording, audio description recording, that kind of thing. And so, just like the music world, you know, people ask me whether I can just sit and listen to music and appreciate it for what it is without analyzing it. And I must say, it is difficult. It is possible, but it is difficult because I sit there and I go, ah, oh, that snare sound. Oh, you know, it's, I wish they would have done this or that or whatever it is. And it's, and it's pretty much the same with audio description. I mean, how could you not sit there and roll your eyes when something is like suddenly ducked so far down that you hear the audio description clearly, but you hear none of the program material behind it. And then suddenly that program material shoots up. It's very distracting, you know? So, you know, as a professional, I sit there and I listen, and I go, ah, oh, that's terrible. I wish they did a better job. Or you marvel at the great job that is sometimes done, you know, because I know the challenges. And so, you know, when it is well done, then it's really a pleasure. But then, of course, at the same time, just as a consumer, hey, I'm happy that we have as much audio description as we do. But even there, you know, you get disappointed when, you know, you find things that aren't described or partially described or poorly described. Oh, it's a never ending list, a laundry list of, you know, wishes and, you know, complaints. But anyway.
Sure. And I hear the, you know, I hear the disappointment too. There's a one of the things that happens in these conversations is that, it is a form of discrimination that sighted people are able to immerse themselves into the story without these barriers that are put upon our audio description audiences, in the sense of, you know, whether it's the assumption of we've got to get this out really fast or we don't have a lot of money or whatever barrier, maybe it's even a lack of professionalism, any of those things. And what I'm hearing in a lot of conversations, I'm curious your take on this, is that if we use the analogy of the digital audio workstation as a change in technology that that gave fewer barriers for you to be able to develop your career. And also, I think you had said that you'd never considered a career before in audio engineering, but now you could. That tells me that it's technology and culture that are changing. And I'm getting the sense with over 8,000 titles in film and TV specifically, that have audio description, that those two things, the career and the technology, or sorry, the technology and the culture are changing to accommodate and allow that immersive experience for our audience. Is that could you address that if you agree, disagree, or maybe some nuance to it?
Well, I think that certainly, I mean, we live in a technology-driven world, you know, really like it's all around us, you know, and I mean, I think it's fantastic. It's great. It's one of the things that allows me to do the work that I do. I mean, back in the analog days, you know, certainly if that's still the way it worked, I could get by, I could still work, but you know, given the fact that we're in a technological, a digital technological world, so many things can be made more accessible. The trouble is, of course, with the proliferation of such digital technology, you know, there are so many things popping up, so many new things, new technologies, that often they are not very accessible, or the developers sort of they don't consider the accessibility of their technologies. One analogy that somebody once used that I think is great, it's like you know, you build a house, a building, and then somebody says, well, you know, you only have staircases. What about wheelchair users? You know, you should have put an elevator in. And to then put an elevator in after the building is built is tremendously difficult and expensive and probably impossible in most cases. But had you planned on it to start with, it would have been so much easier, would have been less expensive, would have been a little bit more work, but would have been accessible to all. So I find that with technology, we have that kind of a situation these days. But at least from culturally speaking, from the perspective of awareness, I mean, we do have a lot more awareness these days regarding audio description, for example. I mean, the fact that a lot of programming is out of the gate described is fantastic. I mean, it's something that, you know, 20 years ago, I would have never, it was a dream, you know, at that time. We were just excited to get, you know, a mandate of a few hours of, you know, programming. I mean, that's like, you look back and you think, wow, you know, it's so much better. But of course, with progress, you realize, well, we have so far to go too, you know.
Yeah. And gosh, I knew we'd get the nuance with you. This is great. Thank you for both examples of the planning, the building, and how much easier it would be and less expensive if you do ahead of time and not the afterthought. Mm-hmm. And that awareness thing on the cultural side, this is gold. Is anybody listening? Can we make a money quote here? Is that what we're talking about? Anyway, thank you for that. let's, if I could ask specifically about audio description, you had addressed the ducking issue. Most of our audiences in this podcast understand that's, you very clearly shared it too. So we don't have to go over that. Is there something else that you see as when you're analyzing audio description, either as a audience member or a professional, that's just like, oh, this is something that it would be so much better if, and then how would you fill in that blank?
Well, I mean, aside from that technical issue that I think everybody, you know, everybody knows what we're talking about when we're talking about, you know, the audio of the program audio dropping out suddenly, you know, to an extreme degree. And that's just poor engineering in terms of mixing. Aside from that, you know, I don't think anything else from a technical point of view is a big problem these days. I think that most description, and I'm talking about description that is done like by human voices, nothing, you know, not synthesized speech or anything like that, because that I don't approve of at all. I think that the description itself, the quality of the writing, I mean, that's always a thing that, you know, it's probably more of a personal preference of things. I mean, you know, I know that there's probably quality control, although there is quality control done by description companies. But I think a lot of the stuff, you know, is just a superfluous description, or things like, you know, you get some programs where like the only description you get is in the kitchen and that's it, you know, and then the rest of it is like, you have no idea. I mean, I you know, at that point, it's quality of writing. I mean, I think that's what it really mostly boils down to. Of course, I personally can't stand when description is written in such a way that the writing sort of addresses the intention of the character and stuff like that, where you know, don't tell me what you think the character is thinking. Describe their facial expression, you know, tell me what their body is doing. I know, you know, what a raised eyebrow means. You know, I can infer just like a sighted person what that means, but don't tell me, don't feed me that if you think I can't understand that, then you're describing down to me. Don't describe down to me. I think I'd say it that way.
Yes. Oh, that's great. That's funny. We've also talked even on the voiceover side of that down to me attitude that we've brought up a few times, that Netflix in their publicly available quality control requirements for audio description companies, it addresses that narrator who speaks in a sing-songy tone, which sounds like that you're 4 years old, or, you know, it's like that comes across as condescending, and that down to me can apply, obviously, as you addressed, to the writing, to the laziness of a mix, or even the voice talent performing in a way that doesn't work. If this is great, if you were to think about where you yourself, your career, continue to evolve, do you see it growing in the same trajectory? Do you see jumping ship and going into a different direction? What's the dream scenario for you, if you don't mind me asking, if that's not too personal?
The dream scenario is to retire.
There we go.
No, don't get me wrong. I love what I do. And I'm excited every day when I get to the studio. I will always work in some capacity, in audio. My first love is music, and I'm a musician, a songwriter, a composer. So that's my first love. And I got into audio to be able to record my own material in demo form, you know, to shop it around, that kind of thing. And then the further I got into the world of audio, the more fascinated I got. And it was all, it's all problem solving. I mean, I frankly think life is just one big problem solving, a continuous series of problem solving sessions. Because, you know, what's the problem? I get up, you know, what's the problem? I gotta get in better shape. So you get on the treadmill. I'm hungry. That's a problem. What am I gonna do? Oh, I'm gonna have to make some lunch. You know, it's all a series of problems. How am I gonna pay my bills? Well, I have to work. Okay. I got into industrial design as a college student. Industrial design, by definition, is just a series of tasks, problems to be solved. How do I build a better vacuum cleaner? How do you design a better chair, more lightweight, more stronger, this and that? It's all a series of problems. And it's the same in audio. How do I record, a vocalist playing guitar without having the guitar bleed into the vocal mic too much, without the vocal bleeding into the guitar mic too much, without having phasing issues? It's just an endless series of problem solving. So I found that fascinating. And, and I think that I will always continue to appreciate the tasks involved in that. I said it as a joke, but I really do mean it. I think the ultimate goal is to retire, in the sense of not necessarily needing to work as an audio engineer full time, but more so as a composer. My wife and I have been working on an idea for a musical. But to do that, you really need to devote yourself full time for years. And my wife took an early retirement. And so now I think she's kind of tapping her toe, waiting for me to retire from my job so that we could work on this. I say that half jokingly. She isn't. She says, you do what you need to do, whatever you want, we can work on this whenever. But I think I'm at the point where I'm saying I'm going to probably, over the course of the next couple of years, kind of more selectively choose the projects I work on, so that I can devote more time to composition, to writing.
Very cool. What a great focus. And to know that you're being compensated for the value that you brought to be able to get to that place of retirement. It's great to know that we can all follow that lead as needed. Thanks for sharing that. And congrats on that. That's very exciting. I can't wait to hear it, watch it, everything. So, I know that's going to be down the road, but that'll hopefully come soon.
I hope so.
Anything else you'd like to share with our audience?
One thing that was so, I don't mean to, you know, get to land on a negative here, but it is disheartening. You know, a couple of weeks ago, my wife and I started watching the first episode. It really drew us in. And then the second episode, you know, it continued and stuff like that. And the third episode, no description. I thought, that's weird. We thought, well, okay, well, let's see if we, you know, we tried to access it, you know, a different way and this and that. And I was so disappointed to see that the rest of the series, you know, didn't have description. And I see online discussions, you know, where, you know, the person who described it said, you know, well, actually, yeah, all of the episodes were described, but for some reason FX only like included two episodes and claimed that only two episodes were contracted for description.
Oh, wow.
I mean, that's bizarre. Why would they pay for seven episodes and then only put out two? It just doesn't make sense. So it's disheartening when things like that happen. But, you know, there are a lot more people that are a lot more people around these days that are more vociferous in terms of picking up the phone, emailing, calling to complain. And that kind of pressure can sometimes really, you know, help raise awareness, and then you sometimes do get results. So hopefully something will happen with that particular series, because I want to watch it.
Sure. And I love that you know, these are systemic changes that are happening, that it's to be in the position of making that phone call and saying, hey, the elevator goes to the first three stories, but doesn't go all the way up.
Right, exactly.
Your analogy here. It's like, that doesn't make sense. And it's like, right. Oh, well, you know, hopefully back to that problem solving. Let's turn this into a positive, that the companies that are now at the point of understanding what audio description is, it's like, oh, we've got a breakdown somewhere. We do need to describe the entire series. What happened and how can we prevent that from the future? That is the microphone vocal guitarism of audio description.
Yes, it is. It absolutely is. Yeah.
Is there anything, how can we reach you either on following a website, on social media?
I mean, yeah, I mean, I do. I used to have a podcast, which I keep threatening to revive. We'll see. Maybe if I do take on a few less clients, maybe I will revive that. And that's sessionswithslau.com. So that's sessions with SLAU.com. I do have a Twitter handle. So I'm sort of a little bit more active on Twitter, and that's Slau B Sharp. That's SLAUBE SHARP. B Sharp is the name of the studio here in New York City where that I own and operate. And Slau Halatyn on Facebook. And that the last name is Halatyn. I'm not big on Facebook, but I'm there. So I do kind of keep an eye on Facebook a little bit. How could you not these days? You have to. And I think those are the way. I'll mention email in case somebody needs to reach out via email instead of the social media. And that'll be Slau at bsharpstudios.com. BESHARPSTUDIOS.com.
Perfect. Thanks so much for joining us, Slau.
Thank you, Roy. It's been a pleasure.